okay. I've had a tendency to be itching my nose at the start of every program the last couple of times, so I'll do my best to avoid that temptation. I'm going to quickly do a quick bit of business here. I'm pasting my tip jar in the comments section, so it's easy to find. I'll preface my whole show by just saying that I appreciate greatly some of your loyal support. This is my second anniversary show, so I'm in a reflective mood. I started it 2 years ago on February 19th, and it was not arrived at lightly, and that's an understatement, friends. I was planning a webcast for along the lines of 15 years. I go way, way back to the stage of where people had to get licenses from their local cable company to do a webcast. You had to get special software, and I looked into it for years. I tried the original YouTube method, which was completely faulty. It was all distorted. I tried that. That was a misfire. There was all kinds of bugs to work out for years. And then Facebook finally came up with this. And then I use an interface. Is that what it's called? Called OBS. And that was a key piece of the puzzle to get that together. And then I experimented with different microphones for a couple of months. I started out using like a $1,000 Neumann, which sounded horrible. I realized it didn't match up well with the streaming software. So that was a bust. And now, if anybody's interested, I'm using really the world's most popular webcasting mics. I'm using two Audio Technica 2020s, a match set. And I've been very, very happy with the sound that they get. And I've gotten a lot of good feedback from you all. Let me reflect on how it's gone for 2 years. I had both higher expectations for the show, and in other ways, it's exceeded my expectations. I thought there was going to be a way to link to other people's websites, et cetera, and that I was really going to grow the audience over the last couple of years. But that's the story of my life. I'm the master of self-promotion, right? That's being facetious. I've never figured it out. I've never figured out how to get the numbers up on anything I've ever done. I'm not crying about it. I'm happy that I have you guys, this loyal group that does show up. And then we get some high-class music professionals in the chat room every once in a while. Ed Stasium shows up, who produced the Ramones and Living Color and Talking Heads. An old friend of mine, Mike, Kathy, and Alan from Bailey and the Boys show up. He might be around tonight. Oh, and Alan's last appearance, which was at the beginning of February, was probably my most popular video in a long time. And we replay them on YouTube. So if you don't catch the live broadcast, so to speak, you will be able to watch it after the fact. If anybody's out there, by the way, say hello. And I want to say hello to some of the people who don't necessarily show up in the chat room, like Marty, and thank her for her very faithful support. And exciting for me is that Alan's coming back, and as a matter of fact, he will likely be kind of a regular here. We'll probably do a Chip and Alan thing once a month. And because he's kind of retired from the road. When he came back from Europe this past fall, he basically said that's my last tour of Europe for a while, and wants to stay home more. So we're going to reap the benefits of that. And very excitingly, I want to tell you that the next show is going to be something we're both really, really into, which is lesser known songs from the 60s. So we're probably going to stay away from Beatles. But we are going to do a Rolling Stones song that I'll bet money on the fact that almost no one has ever heard. It was an album cut called The Singer, Not the Song. And you'll see that Jagger and Richard were both really good songwriters way back when. Well, I'm wondering if I'm being heard by anyone. I don't see anybody in the chat room right now. This was a little bit last minute. I only announced it a couple of hours ago. But like I said, there's a lot of potential with the potential with the replay. A lot of people see it on YouTube when I post it after the fact. And tonight we're going to feature blues as a nod to Black History or Black Heritage Month. I prefer to call it Black Heritage Month. We should be aware of Black History every month of the year because it's kind of, it's a people's history. It's our history, all of us. But there's certainly a great heritage of music, to say the least. I was thinking today, and this is going to shock some people, I wouldn't be able to do without Motown in my life. I mean, I would almost, I better not say this, I'm going to get in real trouble. I would almost trade the Beatles for Motown. I just, you know, the tons of great songs from Motown. But fortunately, we don't have to trade. I am going to do a Beatles song tonight. After I open up with this song that I wrote to a Langston Hughes poem. And I might read a couple of poems tonight by a couple of great Black poets. The Beatles song that I'm going to do is entirely appropriate because Paul McCartney has let out in recent years that Blackbird is a song about the racial situation in the 60s. So you'll hear it maybe in a new light if you didn't know that. Has anybody seen the Knives Out movie, Glass Onion? Last night we watched it. It's really quite a hoot. And about the three-quarter mark, I said to Eli and Annie, I said, I wonder if they've spent the requisite $1 million to get the rights to the Beatles song Glass Onion as the closing theme. I didn't know if they had, and of course, yes. Boom, boom, at the end, the two flams on the drum come in, and the Beatles sing Glass Onion over the credits. But as they're going to the Greek island, and I won't say anything about the plot, but one of the main characters, Miles, is playing this on the guitar. He's playing a Martin D28. And I said to Eli, see, you know, this is the most evergreen guitar part of all time. And everybody should learn it who wants to impress their friends, etc., and have something fun to play for the rest of their lives. And one of his friends comes up and he hands her the guitar. He says, this is the guitar McCartney wrote the song on. He's a multi-billionaire. And so you're supposed to believe that. McCartney still owns that guitar. Of course, he would never sell it. And I think the guy even makes a joke and says, I was kidding, or something like that. that guitar will probably be left to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame or someplace like that. When McCartney records an album, even now, he still uses that guitar, that Martin D28 that he bought all those years ago and wrote Blackbird on. And it's really a testimony to how great those guitars are, because that guitar sounds good 100% of the time. This is a Martin, and it's also made out of rosewood like his guitar. But this is a Norman Blake. It's a good blues guitar. So let me get to some blues here. This is the song I wrote to Langston Hughes' poem, Blues at Dawn. And I went through channels and got permission from his estate, which is represented by some lawyers in New York City. And it was easy. They were very nice, very friendly. Contrary to a lot of other people who make it a nightmare to try to get permission to use something. My friend Jenny tried to get permission to use a Robert Frost poem, and they just laughed at her, basically. No, we don't allow anyone to use Robert Frost's poems for musical purposes. Okay. If you're there, say hi. I'm still kind of hanging fire, but I'm going to start playing at this point. And here's the song Blues at Dawn by Langston Hughes. And I never thought I'd hear myself say this, but by Langston Hughes and Chip Murgaugh. I don't dare start thinking in the morning. I don't dare start. I thought them thoughts in bed, you know them thoughts would bust my head. So I don't dare start thinking in the morning. That's a bad way to start that sentence. I wanted to say it's on iTunes, Spotify, etc., 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 whatever. And there's a live version of it. It's called Blues at Dawn Live, I believe, on Spotify. So it's kind of similar to what I just did with one acoustic guitar, in case you'd like it. That's one of the things about the webcast that I've learned over the last 2 years. I used to tout my books here and hold them up, and I have 3 books, including my new children's book, which is called Garbo Speaks, which is about Garbo, the ukulele-playing raccoon who lives in a garbage can. And, you know, I don't think I sold a single book doing that, so I'm not going to keep using this kitchen time with you to tout my merch. You know, it doesn't do any good anyway. But if you're interested in downloading the song for 99 cents, you can get it on Spotify. Nobody does that anymore anyway. They just say to you know who, the lady's name begins with an A. Can you imagine if you had a girlfriend named Alexa? Oh my gosh, how complicated would that be to live in your house? Alexa, would you get me a cup of coffee?
Are you trying to shop for a cup of coffee?
See? Alexa, stop. Alexa, stop. I'm going to do some more blues here. This is a song. Very old blues. It doesn't have a very clear origin story, really. And it's been claimed by a bunch of people. But it goes way back. I learned it from the Glenn Gamble Good Time Hour, believe it or not. And this is the great old blues called Sitting on Top of the World. I think Sonny Boy Williamson recorded, maybe Howlin' Wolf. And it's a little finger-picking deal. So I'm going to move this mic a little bit closer and play it for you. It goes like this. It was in the spring, sunny day, when my baby left me, she went away. Now she's gone, gone. I don't worry, 'cause I'm sitting on top. An emery board close by. I just did this. You know, James Taylor carries a nail kit with him on the road. You guys all know that. Naturally, I don't have one here. You'll have to excuse me for a minute. Be right back. Don't abandon me here. Naturally, they're all over the house except when you need one. So when James Taylor breaks a nail, what does he do? His whole style is dependent on his nails, and they're long. I've seen James Taylor's hand on his videos. Gosh, he's got the long nails on his right hand. How does he shake hands? He probably warns people, be careful of my nails. But he'll just repair it himself, or else the show is canceled. It's like, remember the great Kenny Rankin, who only had one guitar? Hey, good. Okay, thanks. Is it Henny? Let me... Yeah, Henny. Dr. Henny, good to see you. It's a rare, quiet night here, Henny, so glad to have you. And maybe Roy is in the house, too. So I'm currently working very slowly on an album called Grace Notes. And I've written probably 50 songs during COVID. So who knew? I guess there's going to be a lot of COVID songs coming out from people. But on the first one, and I'm recording some of it at my good friend Jamie Flynn's home studio. And I'm going to record one of the oldest blues in America, and nobody knows the origin of this. It's attributed to Anonymous. I'm going to play it for you tonight. It's also thought of as not only a standard blues, but a jazz standard too. I recommend the Louis Armstrong version or the Jack Teagarden version especially, although one of those versions is really hard to listen to. It's so badly recorded. But this is called St. James Infirmary. It goes like this. History Month is February, Black Heritage Month. I've damaged this fingernail. Now, digging in. It's an awkward compromise. My friend Livingston Taylor wears metal finger picks, which I just despise those. And he plays with his fingers if he's playing you a song one-on-one. He doesn't put his finger picks on, but he does on stage. Here's the song that the guy is playing as the people disembark and land on his Greek island. The greatest acoustic guitar song ever written. And we know now McCartney wrote it about the racial situation in the 60s. Blackbird singing in the dead of night. Take these broken wings and learn to fly for your life. You were only waiting for this moment to rise. Blackbird singing in the dead of night, yeah. Take these sunken eyes and learn to see all your life. You're only waiting for this moment to be free. Dark black song. He still does it live in concert at the age of 81. He had dinner down in Asbury Park with Bruce and Patty, Paul and Nancy. They ate at a restaurant called Jimmy's, a traditional family-owned seafood restaurant. And Jimmy's mom still is the hostess there. And she was interviewed afterwards. And she said, "We treat everybody exactly the same." And Paul was driving himself, not being chauffeured. And I think he has an Aston Martin, among many other cars, probably. But he was pulled over by an Asbury Park cop, and for what reason? He was driving on the wrong side of the road, friends. So how would you like to be an Asbury Park cop and look through the tinted glass and see that you're talking to Sir Paul McCartney and you're going to recommend that down here in Asbury Park and everywhere else in America, we actually drive on the right, Sir Paul? Maybe I'll play a little of my blues hero of all time. Which is Blind Willie Johnson, who was from Texas. And I have a song about him called Blind Willie Blues. Maybe I'll play it, I don't know. Not super in the mood to play that song. But it does tell his story, so for Black Heritage Month, might be appropriate. But if I could only have one Blind Willie song, it would be this one. This is, you're going to need somebody on your bond. Johnson. Years ago, in my naive youth, I would walk around and go to clubs and I'd ask people. I even asked an old blues singer one time, "What's the meaning of the blues, sir?" Never thinking I'd get an answer. And this guy, this old blues singer, told me all the great blues are about homelessness. I was like, what? He said, yeah, we were picked up out of our home and carried to another country, and we never really felt at home here for years anyway. And I thought about it, and there was some real interest to me in what he was saying. And so I did release an album way back when, in 1989, called My Home Isn't in This World. And I tried to write that into a song, and it was maybe one of the hardest songs I ever tried to write, friends. It had 14 verses to it, I think, and it boiled down. One night I told the story of when I was working on it at my parents' farmhouse in Kingwood, New Jersey, and I finally got so frustrated I just got up and left and went out. And I went to New Hope, and actually I parked in Lambertville, and I was walking the dark streets of Lambertville thinking about this topic over and over again. My home isn't in this world. And I wasn't even sure I was on the right track. I wasn't sure of, and Maria Muldaur was playing that night at John and Peter's, and this great guy, Ricky, hi, Scotso, and this great guy, Ricky, was the doorman and the manager, and he was so nice and so good to the local musicians. And when he met me, he said, Chip, anytime you want to come in to a show, just pop in. I'll let you in. I'll find you a seat. I won't even charge you. So that night I went over to see Maria Muldaur at the end of her set. I had met her during the day. That's a whole other story. And I wasn't even really planning to go see her, but she was managed by the same guy that Bonnie Raitt was managed by, Gary George. And in any event, I go over, and she gets an encore. It's the very last song. I'm sitting in the dark, pondering this, my home isn't in this world topic. And I'm thinking, well, Maria Muldaur is a real archivist, and she knows every kind of music. And, you know, she could do anything here. What is she going to do? I was thinking to myself. And she called her band back up to the stage, and she said, I'm going to do the old blues. There must be a better world somewhere. And, of course, I almost fell out of my chair. And there's a couple of more stories, too, about how I was encouraged to keep writing. But I'm going to blast, not guitar-wise, I'm going to really go for it tonight. A lot of times I don't do the last verse in the original key because it's too high and too intense. But tonight I'm in the mood to do that for you. So here we go with the song I wrote. Called My Home Isn't in This World. No, no, no. Cause I'm just looked down on. I can't stand up straight. Like a tree, the wind is blown, yeah. My home isn't in this world, oh. I feel so alone, friends. That's available out on the internet. The bass player for the Dixie Dregs played on that recording. Great bass player. And what am I doing? I'm trying to put that in the stand. I got a couple of more songs. Maybe I will do my biography song about Blind Willie. I also wrote a song about Robert Johnson, too. So these songs are kind of bookends. And they're also joined in a little trilogy by a song I wrote about Bonnie, not Bonnie Raitt. Although she's worthy of a song, isn't she? I wrote a song about Bessie Smith called Bessie's Blues. I can't do that for you tonight, but... This is a show with a special nod to Black History Month. And I think that's a compliment, maybe. From Scott, I don't know. But this is, you know, you heard that old expression, my songs are like children. I shouldn't say that any one of them is a more favorite than another. Kind of a cliche, but it's a little bit true. But if I had to choose one recording of mine that I like the most, it's a song I recorded in my bedroom called Blind Willie Blues. I play slide on it. I play electric slide on it. Here's my attempt at telling a little bit of his story. So here's the live version from the kitchen of Blind Willie Blues. And thanks in advance for your faithful support. Even if you're seeing this after the fact, the tip jar still remains open. It's really simple to do on PayPal. Annie's not here tonight, so she would usually jump in with the Venmo link. Another big serendipity moment when I was writing My Home Isn't in This World. Maybe if I have time, I'll tell it after this, but let me do this song. Blind Willie Johnson could make a guitar sing. Time that he was 5 years old, he was walking with the king. Born and raised in Texas, he could have sold his soul to play. When he went down to the crossroads, he chose to go the Savior's way. Of his journey must have comforted his mind. Know that John the Revelator spoke of Jesus healing the blind. One day on a corner met a woman named Angeline. They'd be married more than 20 years until death would intervene. Everybody ought to treat a stranger right. He wrote, you're gonna need somebody on your bond. Yes, you are. And dark was the night on Forest Street in Beaumont, on the northern end of town. Well, a fire tore up Willie's house, but it did not burn it down. It happened in the winter, not a soul would take him in. And he died from sleeping in a cold, damp bed. The mystery of sin. Could make a guitar sing. From the time that he was 5 years old, he was walking with the king. Blind Willie Johnson could make that guitar sing. After all these years in glory, He's still walking with the king. I told you that homelessness was considered one of the key elements to a great blues. And so I will do tonight the bluesy version. These are old strings, old cruddy bluesy strings. So I'm wrestling a little bit with the tuning, but it makes it just sound a little bit more like a blues guitar. And this is Bonnie Raitt's version of the Blind Faith song written by Stevie Winwood called Can't Find My Way Home. Come down off your throne, leave your body alone. Somebody must change you. You are the reason I've been waiting so long. Somebody holds the key. Well, I'm near the end and I just ain't got the time. And I'm wasted and I can't find my way home. Come down on your own and leave your money at home. Somebody must change. Well, you are the reason I've waited all these years. Somebody holds the key. Well, I'm near the end and I just ain't got the time. And I'm wasted and I can't find my way. Second anniversary show, and I'm into it. A song by Stevie Winwood. I highly recommend the live version that you can find now, where Stevie and Eric did it at Madison Square Garden. They did a whole different key, same version, but it's more electric in a good way. Thank you for joining me, whether you're joining me live here in the chat room or if you're seeing this on YouTube as a rerun. Thanks for your faithful and generous support. I appreciate it. There's a tip jar here, a virtual tip jar. By virtue of PayPal. PayPal link. And so for the last song, and I've only really scratched the surface, thanks, Bob. Bob's here. I've really only scratched the surface for Black Heritage Month here. But there's a lot of people who consider this song the greatest blues ever written. I'm going to end on it tonight. And they consider this man who wrote it the greatest blues writer who ever lived. Couple of weeks for the return of Alan LaBeouf. We're going to be doing the best of the 60s and a lot of more obscure songs, not the famous Beatles and Stones songs. We're going to be doing some Love and Spoonful things that are rarities to a certain degree. Now for you guitar players, let me see if I can get this guitar in the frame a little bit more. I can. And thanks again for joining me. I wish you a happy and peaceful good night. And this is Robert Johnson's
crossroads, I believe I'm sinking down.